Well, God is good. We had a plan, but things change. Sometimes the Holy Spirit does a little shift. You know, He does a little something different. And so, got a little text message today, and here's our shift. This is Michael. Say hello to Michael, please.
How's it going?
Say hello to Michael. Come on, say hello to Michael.
Yeah, guys, what's up? So, for the past couple weeks, God's been telling me to get baptized. Now, I was baptized at 15, but I did it all for the wrong reasons. I just, you know, someone said get baptized, so I got baptized. Within the year, I was drinking excessively, smoking pot, popping pills, selling weed, selling guns, buying guns, everything that I wasn't supposed to be doing, and Jesus was the farthest thing from my mind. But one night, I decided I was done. I was at men's group, I decided I was done. And then I get a text from my dealer who says, hey, I'll get you an ounce of weed for $75. So my stupid self went going. Went, got my weed, went to sell it for, I don't know, $200-something. And I got a gun put in my face, robbed for all my money, robbed for the weed, and he took off. And immediately, and in that instant, I knew that was God. That was God saying, hey, dummy, get back on track. So I sort of did that. Then about a year later, for my my best friend's 21st birthday, which was in January of 2014, me and him, we drank an entire handle of vodka just to ourselves, which for us was it was nothing, but it's still a lot of alcohol. And that very night, I met the devil. I was in the presence of the devil when I laid down in bed. 1 year later from my birthday, on my 21st birthday, I had one beer. And that was it. Just one beer, caught it a night. Celebrated Jesus with my dad, a couple of my brothers, and a couple of my sisters. And so a couple weeks ago, Jesus said, jump. I didn't say how high. I just jumped with all I had. Now here we are. So if you'd bow your head and pray with me. Father God, I thank you for everything. I thank you for parents who they didn't beat the love of Jesus into us. They taught us the love of Jesus. And I know all 9 of my siblings contest to that. I thank you for a church who loves me. I thank you for my brother Kyle, who's been a really good role model. I thank you for Moses. As many fights as we get into, he always has my back. I just thank you for you, Father God, for always having my back, for filling me with the love of Jesus. I thank you. It's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen.
You know, we always get into fights, right? And sometimes you win and sometimes I win. Well, this time I'm going to win because I'm not asking your permission. I'm going to have your dad join us. That's okay. You can stand there, Ken. You ready to do this for real? You ready? You really ready? What Michael's doing, I'm going to make this quick, is he's making a public profession that Jesus Christ is really the Lord of his life. Cross your legs so I can bump your back. And what he's also telling you is that he's letting you know that you're his brothers and sisters in Christ. And if you see something that he's doing, that when you open up the Bible and you compare his life to it, if it's not there, he wants you to tell him about it lovingly, okay? I'm just going to ask you real quick, and I'm going to have your dad help me. Who, once and for all, I know you'll slip and I know you'll fall, but once and for all, who is your one and only Lord and Savior? Based on that confession, I now bury you with Christ, and like him, you'll be raised to new life because you trusted in the mighty power of God that raised Christ from the dead. We baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Golly. Oh man. How is everybody? Good? Is this on?
Hello?
Yeah, there it is. Man, I'm glad we sang that last song. You know, I didn't really have a clue what was going on here with these guys this week. We had things just come to our church that we just needed to deal with, and so usually kind of know what they're going to do up there, but not this week, but God did, and I am so glad that we just sang, I exalt thee. I'll tell you why. Remember last week I told you we were studying through Joshua that sometimes we don't pray because one, we're lazy, and two, we don't like it when he answers us. Because we don't like what he tells us, we don't want to do it, or he tells us something that we don't think we can pull off, right? And so that's when we have to start praying to the one who could make the sun stand still. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah. So I'm glad that I got to share that with you, because now I'm right here with you, because now I pray, and then he speaks, and I don't want to say what he wants me to say, right? Yeah, it happens. Yeah, it happens a lot. So I prayed, and here we are. So this is one of those weeks that I kind of wish that he didn't tell me anything. So I could just tell you something fluffy and send you on home, right? That would be great. It's just not going to happen that way, Jerry. Just bear with me. I don't want to offend people by my feelings or my opinions. But I decided a long time ago that I have no problem offending you with the gospel. Don't care. If you don't like it, tough. That's okay. I'm compelled. I have to say what I got to say. I'm going to stick by that book. And if you don't like it, that's all right. I'm way more afraid of God than I am of any of you. Okay? So that includes my beautiful little bride. I'm way afraid of God than I am of her. Yes, I am. I am. I am. So we've been going through Joshua, right? And last week we were in chapter 9. And we're in chapter 10, and we're kind of just going through, right? That's what we do here at Revolution. We go through books of the Bible, and God, he's made a book, and it's laid out just perfect, right? I don't have to change anything. It's awesome, right? So I'm just going along. Well, sometimes there's this perfect storm, and let me tell you what this perfect storm is. The perfect storm this week is me reading Joshua, and I went back and I read the whole book again. Like, I didn't just go at 10 and go, okay, what's next, Lord? I went back and I read the whole book, and there's a section in there that is way, way back. It's in chapter 5. Well, that doesn't make sense, right? Because that's not where we're at, God. That's not where we're at. So what do you got in chapter 11, right? Well, it doesn't work that way. The perfect storm is that, and then also what this country, like everything that's going on in our world, like I am so fortunate I don't have cable. For all of you that have cable, I have one thing to say to you. You are stupid. I'm just kidding. I offended you already. I just want to get that out of the gate, right? No. No, like, it's awful, right? Like, is there anything good on? I don't even know. Like, I know one thing. I got rid of it for a couple reasons. One, there's nothing good to watch. And two, I never watched it. So one day I was sitting there, and I'm in my recliner, and I'm looking at this TV that's not on. And I yelled out to Meredith, I said, honey, why do we have that? And she's like, I don't know. Let's get rid of it. And it was like paying like $130 for a box that never turned on. It was kind of stupid, so we got rid of it. But one of the benefits of not having television is that I don't see all this crazy on, and sometimes people have to fill me in. but I do know this, it's kind of crazy out there right now. I don't know if it's any crazier now than it ever has been, but I know that we have phones, so I can see what's going on in China, and I can see what's going on in Puerto Rico. I can see what's going on in your backyard. Google Earth, man. I seen Michael and Dan on a mower the other day. Did you ever see that? That was cool. They were on a mower, and Michael was blowing all the grass all over the street, as usual. You'd think that once you got saved, things would change. My Lord Almighty. but all this stuff's going on, right? It's crazy with the police. You know, we did this thing today with the police, you know, praying for them. But all these policemen are getting shot. Heard of a policeman who was just pumping gas, and some dude went up to him and just said, yeah, you're a policeman. Boom, blew his brains out. Microphone. And so I can't do that. You know that. And so lots of crazy stuff. ISIS, you know, persecution all over the place, and same-sex marriage, and they're talking about pastors not being able to preach the fullness of God's word because it's hate crime, and you know, you're going to have to perform these certain ceremonies even though you don't think you're supposed to, and bakeries getting shut down because they won't cook a cake for a, you know, it's just kind of, it goes crazy, and I don't want to like make it all black and dark and sad in here and all that, and I kind of did that a month or so ago, and we talked about some of the things that are going on in our country and how we should respond, and really the response was this, and I shared out of Job, and it's kind of cool that there's lots of lightning and thunder and rain here tonight, because when you look at the book of Job, you see that it says, God says to Job that he directs every single drop of rain, and he directs exactly where every bolt of lightning will go. Now, so when you see that God, like if he's in that much control, we could just kind of go, you know what, yeah, you got this thing. Like, we don't have to be freaked out and worried about it because God is, this is a newsflash for some of you. God is on his throne. It doesn't make any difference what you see on the news. It doesn't make a difference how much worse it gets. God, Almighty God, the creator of heaven and earth, is on his throne and he's spinning this earth on his finger like a Harlem Globetrotter. On his recliner with his feet up. It's no big deal for him. And we go freaking out about it. God is in control. So I don't want to go back there, but I do know that there's a way that Christians should conduct themselves. We know God's got it, right? We know God is in control of heaven and earth. He's got this thing. He didn't look and go, oh, I can't believe he got elected. It slipped through the cracks. What's wrong with you, angels? You let this... No, it didn't happen. God is in control. So he's got this thing under control. We don't have to freak out, but there's a way for us to live while we're here as Christ followers. Now that displays itself and it's fleshed out in a variety of different ways. There's diversity in the body of Christ, and that's why it calls for harmony. Harmony meaning different voices coming together to make something more beautiful than any one of those single voices could ever do on its own. And that's us. There's diversity in the body of Christ. We saw that on display today at the Eustis Police Department as we looked over 100 people in the circle of every denomination, every ethnicity. Some were probably rich, some were probably poor, some had their badge on, and they were important, powerful people in our community, and then some, who knows, maybe they were homeless. I have no idea, but there was diversity in the body of Christ, and we should encourage. That's good. But there's a way for Christians to act, and this is what I want to talk to you tonight about. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to grab a Bible, and if you don't have one, there's plenty of orange and yellow ones all around. And I want you to turn with me to Joshua chapter 5. I want to read something. And if it ticks you off and you don't want to hear it, I'm not going to apologize because it's just what this says. And you're going to have to deal with it. I think that what we need to deal with tonight is really, it's an identity issue. It's our identity. It's our priorities. It's a heart problem, really, that I think a lot of us have. These verses that I'll share with you are going to be up on the screen. The page will be up there. You can go ahead and look them up in those Bibles. And if you don't have a Bible, you can take one of those home with you. It's our gift to you. Now, I want to do this. I want to read the end of chapter 5. It's just three short verses. And I read this. I was like, I got to do this. And I didn't want to, but I'm just gonna. This is what it says. This is just before Joshua gets to Jericho to have this famous story where he marches around the city with his people and they yell and the walls just fall down and they go in and they win, right? This quote-unquote battle, although there was really no battle at all because the opponents were paralyzed with fear. But just before that, here's the army. They've crossed the Jordan River, and they're ready to go start this campaign to conquer the promised land and to gather up this land that God had promised them years before. And so they know there's going to be lots of battles. Here we go. Army's ready, and here's what happens. When Joshua was near the town of Jericho, he looked up, and he saw a man standing in front of him with sword in hand. Joshua went up to him and demanded, "Are you friend or foe?" "Neither one," he replied. I am the commander of the Lord's army. It's an angel standing before him. At this, when Joshua realizes who and what this is, Joshua fell with his face to the ground in reverence. I am at your command, Joshua said. What do you want your servant to do? The commander of the Lord's army replied, take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy. And Joshua did as he was told. Now, do you guys ever hear, I'm lame, I listen to the Z, you know, I'm just a Christian guy. Did anyone ever hear that scene group, For King and Country? Yeah. You ever hear that group? I don't even know if they're any good, but I've heard of the name, so we do a little play off that. I don't always name my message, but I'm gonna change the name of their group for us, and I'm gonna call it For King or Country. For King or Country. Remember I said it was an identity issue. I think that we have a widespread epidemic in our country. And here's the first thing I want to point out to you, and I want to dive into, and that is this. We talk about identity. First and foremost, if you're a believer, the first thing that you have as an identification mark is that you are a disciple of Jesus Christ. That is who you are. Now, you can get involved in a lot of different things, but the numero uno thing is that you are a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you look at the text, and this is what kind of grabbed me, and listen, in this time right now when there's a lot of patriotism going on in our country, I don't want to like purposely tick you up, but just hear me out, okay? Just hear me out. When I read this, I see Joshua, who's the leader of this nation, and great things are happening, and he's on the winning side, and he's leading these people, and things are going well, and he seems to have this a little bit of an arrogance to him. He goes up to this person, he goes right up to him, and he demands something. He said, are you friend or foe? There's a little bit of arrogance about him. There's a little bit of sense of entitlement in him as he demands to know what side this man is on. Joshua, as many of us feel, Joshua felt that his thing was the main thing. And he just went right up to that thing. He didn't know what it was yet. A person, he says, he goes up to him, he demands, whose side are you on, friend or foe? Forces him to make a decision. And I think Americans, as a whole, I think that we're a little bit like that. I'll explain why. Now, here's where the offense begins. Now, you stay in your seat, please, and hear me out, okay? Listen, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
All right.
Let me tell you something. No, hold on. No, hold on, Frank. Be careful what you give your heart to. Be careful what you give your heart to. I love this country, but be careful what you give your heart to. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 4:23, above all else, guard your heart. Guard your heart. And for the Christ follower, the throne of your heart only seats one, and Jesus Christ deserves to be on it, and he will not share his throne with anyone else. Anyone else. You are not American Christians. You are Christians living in America. Philippians 1:27 says that we are not citizens of this world, but of heaven. You are not disciples of America. You are not disciples of the Republican Party. You're not disciples of the Democratic Party. You're not disciples of anything else. If you're a believer, you're a disciple of Jesus Christ. And his nation, otherwise known as the church, spans the globe and extends to the ends of the earth, and it transcends all governments, all economies, all policies, and all geography. It spans the world. Now Joshua demands, are you friend or foe? He draws a defining line based on a false sense of importance. Are you here or are you there? Are you on our side or are you the enemy? And I love God's answer. You look back in the text, what does he say? He says, through this angel, I'm neither. And I love that. And God does that on occasion in the scriptures. I love when he gives an answer that nobody expects. He has this knack, this Jesus, of giving an answer that you would not expect. I find the best one is in Matthew 22, when this group of Jewish religious folks come to him and they want to try to plot to trick God. Stupid, okay? But they think they know it all. So they try to ask him a question where they can try to trick him and make him look bad, and that way they can accuse him and kill him, right? So, hey, should you pay taxes? Well, if he says no, right, then they could kill him because he's a rebel against the Caesar. But if he says yes, the Jewish people are going to hate him because why are we paying Caesar? So, like, either way, he can't win. So what does he do? He gives a neither answer. He says, hey, give me that coin you got. Give me that money. Give me your money. No, I'm just kidding. He says, give me that money. And he says, you know the story. Look here, whose picture's on that? Caesar. Oh, give to Caesar what's Caesar's. Give to God what's God's. You know? He has this way of I don't know if it's dodging the question or hitting it right between the eyes, just the way it's supposed to be. But when he says neither, he's saying, listen, you got to shift your thinking. The question shouldn't be, little people, am I in your war? The question should be, are you in mine? Are you in my war? See, God's quest, this is another offense, but listen, God's quest is not to strengthen the American economy or to reform Obamacare. He's not a member of the NRA, okay? He's not, and he doesn't have a favorite football team, although I think he's partial to Mr. Tebow. The Bible says that he has glorious, unlimited resources, but I'll tell you one thing, he's not spending any of it on campaign finance reform or building walls to hold out immigrants. That is not what God's spending his time or money doing. He's doing other things. Let me tell you what he's doing. I got a list of things that God is doing. He's doing it right now. He was doing it before you got here. He's going to be doing it after you leave here. This is what God's doing. He's not separating people. He's not fighting against each other. He's not saying, hey, well, let's build up this country. No, he's not doing that. This is what he's doing, Ephesians 6:12. He says, our battle, and if this is God's battle, then it's your battle if you're a disciple. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the evil rulers and authorities in the unseen world, mighty powers of this dark world, and evil spirits in the heavenly places. God is saying that our battle and his battle is against this host of demonic, ugly, this force, this evil that permeates your hearts and your thinking that makes you greedy and selfish and bitterness and resentment and hate and wants to kill each other and rob from one another and steal from everybody. All that stuff that makes you evil. That's what we're fighting. We're not fighting against people. We're not fighting against people. It says in Luke 19:10 that Jesus said he came to seek and save that which was lost. What he's saying here is that before the fall, he created this amazing, amazing planet with incredible, these two people, and they were going to mass produce, and it was going to be this amazing relationship where they would walk with him and talk with him and worship him and take care of his place, and all of a sudden, sin. And it fractures all of creation. So humanity fell, sickness and death and war and famine and enmity between animals and people and strife in your home and divorce and fighting and drugs and alcohol, sin after sin after sin. That was the fall. And what God said he wants to do is he wants to restore it back to the way it was and make it good worldwide, not just here in your country. We're so focused on our country. He said he came to seek and save that which is lost in America, in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Cuba, in Russia, in China. That's the mission that God is on. And that's the mission that he's called you to be on. 1 Timothy 2:4, it says that God, our Savior, wants everyone to be saved and to understand the truth. He wants everyone to be saved, no matter what country they're in, no matter what party they represent, no matter where they live, no matter what their socioeconomic status is, no matter what their profession is, male, female, rich, poor, young, old, he came for all to be saved and to understand the truth. God is good. Just two verses later, he's explaining this again. It says that Jesus gave his life to purchase freedom for this awesome word. Everyone. Everyone, we've got to get a bigger vision, Revolution Church, of what God and you are up to and what you should be investing your life into. He gave his life to purchase freedom for everyone. Romans 3:22 also says of this purchase that we are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus. And I love this. I love this. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who they are. Every single person. Now, you've got to get your mind around this. It's beyond the borders of the United States of America. Jesus is bigger than that. And we need to be bigger than that, than just thinking about our little country, our pile of dirt. It's for everyone. He loves them all. John 10:10 said that the enemy came to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus came that you might have life and life abundantly. He wants all these people. This song said above all gods. I don't even like that line. There are no other gods. There's only one God. He created us all in his image, and he wants the worship of every single human being on this earth. That's what he's after. That's what he's after. And that's what we should be after as the church of Jesus Christ, that all people would know him and love him and worship him and him alone, to enjoy him and to enjoy his stuff. That's what he's all about. That's the war that you've been called into. Jesus didn't die so America could flourish and that all Americans would be, you know, all conservative, right-wing, gun-toting Republicans. That's not what being a Christian is all about. He did not get whipped and beaten and spit on and slapped and stripped and ultimately killed so you could be a Democrat. That's not what he did. He lived, he died, he blessed people, he healed people, he taught people, he loved people, and he endured the cross for one reason, and it's found in Colossians 1:20. To make peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. This gospel is for the whole world. This gospel is for the whole world. And we've got to change the way we think. It's just a priority problem. It's a perspective. And we pour so much resource into other things that mean nothing. Nothing. Here's the thing. It's for everybody. But see, we live here, right? So of course, here is the most important, or so we think. But here's the problem. The people that live over there, to them, they're here, and we're there. Do you see the confusion here? That's the problem. My country, my way, says everybody, everywhere, every day. That's the way it is. But God's like, that's not my focus, though, you know? Remember 1 Timothy 2:4-6, I came for everybody. They would all understand the truth. They would all be saved. See, he's like, that's not my focus is not here. My focus is everywhere. Is everywhere. It's my nation's way bigger. It's the church of Jesus Christ. It's all people of all countries, white, black, Asian, Latino, cops, pushers, tax collectors, hookers, doctors, politicians, rich, poor, young, old, short, tall, every single person. That's what God's building. That's what God's building. So we have to change our perspective. Like, we have our here is the United States of America, and even more so isolated is Florida, and then even more than that is like right here in like Eustis or the Golden Triangle, right? But see, God's here. Like, that's our here, but God's here, right, is all of heaven and all of earth. That's his here. That's his here. So we have to change our perspective because we're to be like him and called on his mission according to his purpose. And that's his purpose. And that's his mission, to reach the world with the gospel that saves souls, not to promote capitalism. That's not what he's all about. Like, it's okay to be involved in those things, but let the main thing be the main thing. That's what we're about. I love this. This is an awesome quote. I don't like to bring the secular too much into preaching of God's word, but I love this. This was back in the Civil War where obviously patriotism on both sides was raging, right? Raging. Whatever side you were on that side, willing to lay your life down for that side. And still going on today. You know, you've seen the thing right now with the Confederate flag. I mean, even now, hundreds of years later, people are passionate about this thing, right? So it's during the Civil War, and there's a bunch of people at the White House, and they gather around Abraham Lincoln, one of the greatest leaders we've ever had, you know? And the guy goes up to him and says, "Mr. President, do you believe that God is on our side?" It's a great question, right? And we always pray for our army and our football team and our basketball team and all that stuff. But this is what Abraham Lincoln said. It was awesome. He said, "Sir, my concern is not whether God is on our side. My greatest concern is to be on God's side."
Yeah.
Yeah. See, he had a healthy and proper perspective. Yes, America is very important, and he's been charged, Abraham Lincoln, to lead that nation. It's very, very important. It's just not the most important. Do you see? You've got to stand for something. Listen, we need to stop substituting the Great Commission, which is to go make disciples and grow the kingdom of God, with the American dream of being happy and, what is it? Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We have to stop substituting that. We've been changed. We're culturizing our Christianity. And our culture is permeating our faith rather than our faith permeating our culture. And the church needs to stand up for what is true and make God's thing their main thing. None of your forefathers, none of them, no matter who they were, Christian or not, none of them died so your sins could be washed away. None of them died so that you might be whisked away into glory eternal with the Father of lights. Not a single one of them. It wasn't Thomas Jefferson who did this for you. It was not George Washington who did it for you. It was not Ronald Reagan, George Bush, Bill Clinton, or Barack Obama. None of them did that for you. They're all fine folks. Now we've got an election coming up, right? And everyone's going crazy. Our Savior, Donald Trump. Like, I don't know anything about Donald Trump. I have no clue whether he'd be a good president or not. I've never met the man. I have no idea. Please. Please. There's one microphone on, and you don't have it. Shush. Thank you. I don't know who you're voting for that you think is the Savior. Whether it be the Don, the good doctor, Jeb, Hillary, Bernie, doesn't make any difference who it is you're going to vote for. None of these fine folks are the Savior. Jesus Christ is. And that's it. That was a great place for an amen. It was a great place for an amen. Listen, if you put your hope in any of them, you are destined for failure. I'm not saying you shouldn't vote, but if you put your hope in any of those men or women, you are failing. Let me tell you why. In 2008, Barack Obama got 66 million votes. That's a lot of votes, don't you think? That's a lot of votes. And I don't understand the whole electoral college thing too much. I understand that you get some votes, you get certain electoral votes, and that's who wins and everything. But at the end of the day, it's supposed to be whoever gets the most votes win, although Al Gore might have a problem with me saying that. But he got 66 million votes. That's a lot of votes, you know? It's a lot. As a matter of fact, he got more votes than anybody. But here's the problem. That same day, 135 million people actually voted. So although 66 million is a lot of votes, the problem was that 69 million failed to get their Savior in office. Now, what do you do? Because it kind of begs the question, what do you do? Like, I felt like this was the person who was gonna recapture the days of old. The days of old weren't that great. And we shouldn't be chasing after that. But we thought we could get this person in. It would be better. Well, then what? Well, let me remind you of something. Psalm 39 was written by King David. Now, King David was the most powerful king Israel ever had. Famous, powerful, strong, win battles like crazy. He would be one of those guys on that list of great men that led a nation. The ones that we would put our hope in, that would conquer and win, and we would prevail and be the powerhouse that we should be. So But here's what King David says. In Psalm 39:7, he's the guy. He's the guy that everyone else is looking for hope to make it better. And he says this, "And so, Lord, where do I put my hope?" If they're putting their hope in me, what am I supposed to do? Where do I put my hope? Very next sentence, right out of his mouth, "My only hope is in you." It's the only way this is going to work. He goes on again, Psalm 37:34. I love this one. Same guy, the guy that people looked for hope in. He says, "Put your hope in the Lord." I love what it says here. "Travel steadily along his path." Travel steadily along his path. Like, don't just when you're reading the scriptures, don't just blow by that. Think about it for a second. Walk steadily. Go steadily along that path. What does that mean? Like, sometimes we get baptized. Not ripping on you, Michael, but you get baptized, right? And you're like, you're right there on the path. That's in his will. He wants you to do that. But then what happens? A little weed, a couple drinks. You know, you just get a little sideways. Walk to the left or the right, right? And God's like, no. Don't. Just stay right here. Stay right here. And then who's in my club? Get ahead of the Lord. Who's in my club? Come on. You don't need me hanging up there. Only Shaniqua. One person, the whole place, right? Come on. Thank you, you lying, cheating people. Oh. Right? Leave me up here. And then sometimes, and you probably don't want to admit this, but sometimes we get behind the Lord because he's like, "Pete, I want you to go do something." And you're like, "I ain't doing that." And he's like, "No, come on, you, let's go. You got to go conquer that hill. Let's go." And you're like, "Oh, no. Go call somebody else. I can't do that." So, and it talks about walking steadily, like keep persevering, right? Keep going. Stay in the tank. Just as you came to the Lord, so walk with him, right? I came humble and broken and in need of him. I'm repenting. I need forgiveness. I'm weak. You're strong. Every day there. The little engine that could. That's what we're supposed to be. Earthly leaders are not your savior. They are not your savior. So why, here's the big question, why then should we shift all of our resources and our focus? See, that's kind of what I'm telling you tonight, right? Shift all of your resources. I'm not talking about your Roth IRA. I'm talking about everything, your thoughts, your time schedule, your priorities, your worldview, your wallet, your gifting, your talents, your time, all of that stuff. Why am I telling you you should shift all that off of Democrat or Republican or left wing or right wing or CNN or Fox or just America in general? Like, that's your main thing, or some sports team, that's your main thing. Why should we switch it from that and reallocate those resources to God's mission? Why would we do that? I'll tell you why. All those other things are absolute exercise in futility. How many in here would admit that they're stupid? No, you wouldn't, right? Okay, I'm trying to get you not to raise your hand. I mean, we're not some of us are dumber than others, but none of us in here are stupid, right? Like, you wouldn't, let me ask you this. If you knew that that chair was absolutely going to collapse upon sitting on it, and I said, "Hey, have a seat," would you do it?
No.
Well, no. No one's that dumb. So let me tell you why it's an exercise in futility. Let me ask you guys a question. How many people were at creation in this room? None. But you believe that God spoke and the heavens and the earth were created because it says it in the book, right? You believe it? Raise your hand. Yeah. Okay. How many people believe that at his command, it closed and all of Egypt flooded? Who believes that? Because it was written in that book. You believe, right? You believe. How many people believe that Jesus Christ got out of a boat and walked right across this water that he created? How many people believe that? Because they weren't there, but you read it, right? So you believe it. And how many people believe that Jesus was in a boat sleeping and there was a big storm and the boat was rocking and it was about to come apart and his disciples said, wake up. And Jesus, the same Jesus who walked on the water he created, looked at the water he created and said, "That's enough." And it was glass. How many people believe that because they said in the book, right? Okay, so you believe what it says in that book, right? Okay, now I just told you that pursuing
anything else other than God's mission is an exercise in futility. Now you're pursuing the flourishing of a nation, that is your main push. We gotta get America back on track. If you're doing that, that is an exercise in futility. Let me tell you why. Go to Acts 17, 26. Thank you for being a church that allows me to do this. Holler when you're there. I want you to read this, guys. I don't want to just read it alone. I want you to put your eyes on God's word. 17:26. Anyone there? Holler. Okay. This is what it says. From one man, that's Adam, he created all the nations. That means every single ethnicity on the planet. That's the word ethnos. Every single people group on the earth. Okay, let's reread it. From one man, he created all the nations throughout the whole earth. He decided beforehand when they should rise and fall, and he determined their boundaries. I ask you, what mission are you on? What mission are you on? He said that he created all the nations, and beforehand he decided their borders and their longevity. He knows he knew when America was going to be formed, and he knows when America will end. He knows when Portugal was formed, he knows when it would end. He knows when Germany was formed, and he knows when it would end. He knows when every single nation would rise up and when every single nation would fall. Do you think Rome thought they'd fall? Do you think the Ottoman Empire thought they'd fall? You think Egypt thought that they would fall? Arrogance. Arrogance. And all of us suffer from it. Our focus as disciples of Jesus Christ must shift, brothers and sisters, must shift from the temporary to the eternal. It must. I want to offer you this too. Go to Psalm 39. Psalm 39 explains why we should change our perspective and not be focusing on the things that are right here before our face. Like, it's okay to engage, but not to make it the main thing. Stop making it the main thing. Psalm 39, 4 and 5. Lord, this is David again. This is this powerful king who could get stuff done. He's got an army at his disposal, right? Soldiers with swords and shields and fire and all that. He could get stuff done. He could conquer. But even him, he says, Lord, remind me how brief my time on earth will be. Remind me that my days are numbered, how fleeting my life is. You have made, watch this, look up here. You have made my life no longer than the width of my hand. Pretty small, isn't it? My entire life is just a moment to you. At best, each of us is but a breath. Just go like this, church. Look, do this with me. Just go, that's what you are. And all of us in this country add it all up, and we're one big, and that's it. You know, there's nothing new under the sun. Every country thought they had it all figured out. Philippians, again, tells us we are not citizens of this place. We are just passing through. We are citizens of heaven. Travel steadily along God's path. What could that look like? I think that God's path would include engaging in situations where there's injustice raging like crazy. I do. I think God's path would include serving the hungry and the homeless and the hurting. I think God's path includes speaking for the unborn. I believe God's path can include upholding biblical convictions and standards. It's all of these things and more. But, and this is a big but, if any of this is done solely to make this a better America and is not being done because of the gospel and so the gospel can be spread to more people so God can receive glory, then I have to tell you that you have a problem with the throne in your heart. God wants the throne of your heart. He wants your greatest endeavors to be His pursuits. His purpose must be our purpose. And so, what do we do? Well, let's go back to the text in Joshua and see what God would have us do. We always go back to the scriptures to get answers. Amen? I love God's word. Joshua realizes that his thing is, it's not the main thing, and that God's war, what God's up to, his purposes, God's thing is the main thing. And so what does he do here? The guy, the angel says, neither one. I'm the commander of the Lord's army. At this, Joshua fell to his face to the ground in reverence. And he changes his perspective. Instead of rushing up and demanding, choose your side, man. You with me or against me? He falls on his face and he says, I'm at your command. Joshua said, what do you want your servant to do? You know what that is? That's repentance. That's repentance. He goes from this he thought, powerful, my things, the main thing guy, rushing up to him going, choose whose side you're on today. Are you friend or foe? And when he realizes that God's thing is the main thing, he changes his perspective and he begins to bow in reverence. And he changes from, you need to decide if you're on my side or on their side, to, oh, I want to be on your side. I want to be on your side. God's not your servant. You're his servant. You're not, God's not here to pursue your dreams. You're here to pursue his dream. And Joshua's response, let me tell you something, Joshua's response is prescriptive. It's for all of us. When we're faced with this choice of making a decision of the priority of our life, this response is prescriptive. It's for you. And he's, what did he do? I am at your command. What do you want your servant to do? That should be our response to God. And so when he's in this wartime context here, and there's swords and shields and angels and fighting and Jericho's right there, what does the angel of the Lord, the voice of God, what does he tell Joshua, this great general? Okay, I want you to do this. I want you to flank him over here. I want you to flank him over here and ambush over here. What does he tell him to do? He says, take off your shoes. He says, worship me. That's what you do. That's what you do. You worship me. You worship me, son and daughter. You worship me. See, all this crazy stuff that's going on here, and all this crazy stuff that's going on in our world right here, and you see it on the news all the time, it seems to be unraveling. It is not motivation to find help elsewhere. Do not be like the children of Israel who lived in bondage and torture for hundreds of years, and when they finally got out and they were delivered through the Red Sea, and they didn't have the food that they wanted, they said, well, let's go back to Egypt to find help. Do you remember that you were whipped and beaten and tortured all those years? Don't look to Egypt for help. God told the nation of Israel before they got their first king, you guys have a king. You want a king? I'll give you a king. He's going to be rotten. Have it till you choke on it, kids. I'm your king. I'm your king. I'm your king. All this crazy stuff is not motivation to find help elsewhere, and it's not fuel for your fire to fix America. Don't worry. Listen, don't worry if preachers are forced by law to stop preaching certain things. Because I'll tell you something, any preacher who loves the Lord, he's going to do it anyway. Okay? Stop worrying about whether they come in the door and say, Moses, you will perform same-sex marriage ceremonies up here, because I'm not going to. Besides that, it doesn't matter what happens on the stage. That's a ceremony. The sin is the practice of homosexuality. That's going on in the bedroom way before they get to that stage. And that's what we need to be working on. The hearts of men and women. That's the job of the church. And you can't legislate righteousness. You have to tell people about Jesus and you pray for them. That's what you do. And don't worry about fake replicas of the Ten Commandments coming out of courthouses, because God's on his throne. and he's building his church, and it doesn't matter what anybody does, the gates of hell will not prevail against the nation of the church being built. It doesn't make any difference what happens. And listen, we are part of that. You are part of that. You are an important part, individually, each one of you is an important part of God building his church. And all this stuff right here that's going on around us, that's all it is fuel for fire. It's a wake-up call for us to worship him in a greater way. That's it. To trust him more, to share him more, to make his thing the main thing. Let me ask you a question. We're not taking sides. Don't you dare tell me that you don't like our president. I don't want to hear it out of anyone's mouth. We're supposed to pray for that man. Listen, if you disagree and you don't think he's a good president, you think he's the Antichrist, and you think all this, and you think, listen, I'm not an Obama fan. I'm not voting for him or not. That's nothing to do with it. If you think for one second that God didn't put him there to drive you to him, we are not there to rally around a president of this little country in this little time in history. We are called, he places governments in effect so we will come to him. And so when you don't like what's going on in the government, don't you think Almighty God was aware of that? And he did it so you would come to him. Come on, right? That's why he does it. All this turmoil, topsy-turvy world that we live in, it's a reason to get on our knees and worship the Almighty. That's what it's all about. That's why this stuff happens. So I want to close with this. Psalm 62. Go there, please. God is good. God is good. God is good. It's a priority thing. Like, it's cool to get involved with other stuff. Right? It's cool. Nothing wrong with it. It just can't be the main thing. It just can't be the main thing. This is a little verse. I share it all the time here. It's your purpose. It's Colossians 1:16. It says, everything was created by him and... Yeah. You created for him. Not the Republican Party. Not the Democratic Party. Not the Libertarians. Not the Tea Parties. Not the no-tax-free people. Whatever. Do what you want. But that's not why you were created. You created for him. To bring glory to God. To share the good news of the gospel that people might get saved and know and love Jesus and worship him. That his name would be famous across the earth. That's why you live. That's why you were made. Here's Psalm 62. Here's the response. This is the Christian. This is you. Let these words tell the story of your life. And then we're going to be done. Let all that I am wait quietly. I'm going to start over. Let all that I am wait quietly before God. For my hope is in him. Do you see yourself walking steadily upon the path right there? Walk steadily upon my path. He alone is my rock and my salvation. My fortress where I will not be shaken. My victory and honor come from God alone. I love this. He is my refuge, a rock where no enemy can reach me. Do you ever think of yourself like that? Do you ever think of yourself like, and you could draw your own picture. I hope that you would. Like the mighty outstretched arm of God around you. Like if God himself would wrap David his arm around you, God, the creator, would you fear anything?
Not at all.
He is, bro.
That's right.
Right now.
We know it, don't we?
Right now. He's the rock. Where if you're, it says in the scriptures that you are seated in Christ at the right hand of the Father right now. Nothing can shake you. It doesn't matter what comes across the TV. Nothing can shake you when you're on his mission. That's what we're called to do. That's what we're called to do. I have no peaceful and smooth segue other than I thank you for letting me speak some truth And I hope that you'll do something with what you heard. I'm going to call the gentlemen forward. They're going to pass out our communion elements. Here at Revolution Church, we take communion almost every week. It's a time of intimacy with God, a time to look back and think about Jesus on the cross and what he's done for you, that you might be part of his family. Maybe it's a time to repent of sin. Maybe it's a time of listening to what you just heard and you feel convicted about something and you need to do some one-on-one work with Jesus. Now's the time. So they're going to pass those things out, and I'm going to ask you to hold on to it, and then we're going to take it together as a family, okay? I'm going to pray with you real quick. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. I thank you personally for letting me be a part of a family that allows me to speak the truth of your word without fear. And I know, Lord, that there's lots of churches out there that if I got up and said these things, they would run me out of there, but not here. Lord, I'm thankful for the hearts that are in this room. And I believe with all my heart, Lord, that these people in this church will do the right thing, and that is to go home and check the scriptures. Check what I've said against God's word, against your word, and see if it's right. I also believe, Lord, I'm that naive, I am that crazy, that foolish to believe that when they hear your word spoken over their life, that conviction will take root in their heart and they will change. That they will give themselves completely to you, and that you will change their life and you will use them on your mission. I thank you, Lord, for pointing out what the main thing is. Help us to get engaged in your thing. I thank you for that. In Jesus' name.